Grace and peace to you from Onalaska First United Methodist Church. You're listening to our podcast. We hope you enjoy. So we are in week three of our Name That Tune Bible edition. If you have been here the last two Sundays, you know that we featured an Eagles song. What was the name of that song? What was it? Love will keep us alive. Love will keep us alive. Okay, that was the Eagles. Then last week we did Johnny Cash, Walk the Line. So I have another song for you this week. Okay? Now, like last week, I'll give you a few hints. See if you can get it. Okay, so this song has been recorded many, many, many times. But the one that's, oh, you know it? You're not supposed to say that. Pretend he didn't say that. He just completely, I shouldn't have asked you that. The version that, did everybody hear what he said? Oh, good, good, good. Oh, my gosh. Okay. The version that I'm thinking of is probably the most famous version of this song. It was recorded by a group, okay, so it's not an individual artist, it's by a group. It was recorded in 1964. It was a British group, okay, so you guys are all now thinking the Beatles, probably. It's not the Beatles, but they were part of the British invasion. But this particular song, other versions of this, Joan Baez did a version. Bob Dylan did a version. That was before this 1964 version. But after that, Dolly Parton did one in the 80s. And then most recently, a group called Alt-J did it. My boys love Alt-J, and they recorded a version of this. But the one that I'm thinking of is from this British pop band. So, Sam, give us just a snippet. Okay. Okay, who was it? Who was the band? The Animals. The Animals. It was the Animals. Yeah, 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 yeah. So, yes. All right, let's go ahead and play some more of that. We got to hear the first verse. Does everybody know this?
There is a house in New Orleans.
Well, here's what I found out in researching this song. The words to this song, it's a traditional folk song, which means we don't know who wrote it. The lyrics have been around forever and ever and ever, and song researchers, Alan Lomax was a famous guy who cataloged music and tried to find the origins of stuff, you know, did a bunch of research on this. We think that the words originally came from England because there were two pubs in England called the Rising Sun, okay? So it's possible that they originated there, but by 1905, we have the first copy of the American version in the U.S. They had switched it from the Rising Sun pub in England to the House of the Rising Sun in New Orleans. So that's in 1905. The melody line, which may be what you're talking about, is the melody line. There is a house in New Orleans. Well, he might be. I don't know. Or I could maybe have this all wrong. But the melody line, because the lyrics were around for a long time, it was a poem, you know, whatever. And people knew this because their parents had sang it, right? So you hear your dad singing this song, and as a kid you grow up, and then you hear it, and you sing it to your kids. It's kind of passed down that way. But then when recordings became available, well, then people started recording this. So you can hear, you can go on Spotify and hear some very, very early versions of it. I'm talking like the 1930s, you can hear it. And so I went back and listened to some of those really, really old recordings, and the melody line was nothing like the Animals, nothing like the one that we just listened to. Woody Guthrie did a version, very different than this. So I wanted to know, okay, well, where does the first recognizable melody line come in that we are familiar with, the Animals version? And in 1948, there was an African-American blues guitarist named Leadbelly who recorded a version, and his version was the first one that I could find that went, "There is a house in New Orleans." It was the first one that did that. Well, then, after that, Joan Baez did it. Her version was like that. Bob Dylan did it. His version was like that. So then the Animals did it. So it's kind of this weird, we don't know where it came from, but the lyrics have been important enough that people kept it around. They kept saying it, they kept singing it, whatever version they were singing. But the Animals did something different with it. Because the original lyrics were from the perspective of a woman who had fallen in love with a drunk and a gambler. And so throughout the song, she is lamenting her choice in men. And she is saying, "Please go tell my sister, don't do what I've done. I've fallen in love with the wrong guy." And that's how the song went the whole time. That all the way up until the Animals, those were the lyrics. The Animals, though, changed it. They changed it to a first-person perspective, and the singer is the guy who is the drunk and the gambler. It changed it completely. So listen to the words. I don't know if you've ever paid attention to these. It says, "There is a house in New Orleans they call the Rising Sun. It's been the ruins of many a poor boy, and God, I know I'm one. My mother was a tailor. She sewed my new blue jeans. My father was a gambling man way down in New Orleans. Now, the only thing a gambler needs is a suitcase and a trunk, and the only time you keep him satisfied is when he's all drunk. Oh, mother, tell your children not to do what I have done. Spend your life in sin and misery in the house of the Rising Sun. I've got one foot on the platform and the other on a train, and I'm going back to New Orleans to swing that ball and chain. Yeah, there's a house in New Orleans they call the Rising Sun, and it's been the ruins of many a poor boy, and God, I know I'm one." Changed it up. If you have a chance, go back and read the original lyrics. They're good, but I like this more. I like this because I can sense this young man's frustration, right? He realized how his life has gone. He followed in the footsteps of his father, probably the only example that he had. And I sense that this young man is looking for meaning and purpose or ultimate fulfillment, and he's looking for it in a gambling house in New Orleans called the Rising Sun. He's going to this place. He says, "I got to go swing that ball and chain." He realizes it's a burden, but yet he just keeps going back and keeps going back. Now, personally, I am not a gambler. I don't have anything necessarily against it. I don't know if I should say that out loud. The Methodist Church discourages gambling. Okay, I will say that. The Methodist Church discourages gambling. It's not a good thing. But just in the real life, in the real world, I don't necessarily have a problem. I know people like to go to Niskila and pull the slots, right? People like to go down to Louisiana and play some blackjack, and my parents love to gamble. I've just never been into it. I've tried, and I lose my money, and I go, "Well, that was a waste of money. I could have done something else with that." But I've heard that the excitement or the feeling when you are gambling, when you're into it, is that the next slot might just be the one. I might hit it big on this next one. Or, you know, blackjack table. This next hand, I might actually win. And so it's that feeling of what if, that just kind of keeps you going. Now, most people that I know, that I've talked to that enjoy gambling, they go with a set amount. You know, I'm going to go with X amount of dollars, and when that's gone, then we're done. And we go home, and we just count it as entertainment. But that excitement builds up from the idea of what if. And if I hit it big, then I'm going to feel a sense of fulfillment from that. Like I went in with this amount of money, and I walked out with four times that. And I'm going to feel a sense of satisfaction from that. It'll make me happy in some sense. That's the feeling that I've heard people describe, or that I imagine when you, if you are into gambling, that you get. And perhaps this is what this young man in the house of the rising sun was feeling. You know, and while I may not be a fan of gambling or a gambler myself, I do know what that feeling is like, to wonder if perhaps the grass is greener somewhere else. And maybe you all have felt that at some time, maybe not in gambling, but in other places. You wonder if I could just get to this place, then I will feel a sense of satisfaction, or I will be happy. Perhaps if I had this certain car, if I could drive around in this car, then I would feel satisfied. If I made this much money, if I could just make this much money, well, then I could just rest and enjoy life. I'm this close. If I could just bump it up. For me, I certainly feel when I graduate. Y'all know I've been working for 3+ years trying to get my master's degree. When I graduate, I will feel a sense of accomplishment that should be satisfying. I should feel happy about that. Or I will feel fulfilled in life when I take this particular vacation. I've never seen this place before, and I think once I see that, we talk about bucket lists. When I see that, then I can die. I'm happy. I feel ultimately fulfilled. But for me, when I get those things, or when I accomplish whatever it is that I think is going to bring fulfillment, I find that I'm still restless afterward. Anybody else experience that? We chase after greener grass, and when we find it, we find that there's greener grass somewhere else.
I'll tell you what I do love to do. I'm not a gambler, but I love me some Amazon Prime.
Anybody else a Prime member? Amazon Prime is awesome. Anything that you want, anything that you need, you can find it at a very good price and have it delivered to your house in 2 days or less. I mean, that's awesome. And so I find that I'm browsing Amazon. You know, there are things that I need this book for school, or I need this. I bought the other day, it was, I'm always carrying around my books for school, and then I've got my favorite pen, which, by the way, Lynn, my favorite pen right now is the one that you gave out at Father's Day. I love that thing. It makes me feel happy. I realized that I was like, I couldn't keep that stuff together, so I went, you know what? I bet somebody makes some kind of a bookmark that's also a pen holder. I found it on Amazon. I ordered two of them. It was at my house in 2 days. And so what I find is that whenever I am on Amazon looking for those things that I think I need, or the thing that will make me feel satisfied or fulfilled, I order it. I find it for a good price. It shows up on my doorstep, and it's like Christmas time. the package is at the house. And you step out and you take it in the house and you open it up and it's exactly what you ordered and it's everything you thought it was going to be. And for that day, you're, I got my bookmark holder, pen holder. But then after a couple days, well, the luster wears off. And so then what am I doing? I'm back on Amazon looking for stuff I need. It's this vicious cycle of looking for meaning and fulfillment and satisfaction in the wrong places. You know, this story about this young man at the house of the rising sun reminds me of another guy in the Bible. He calls himself the teacher. We don't really know his name, but he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes. How many people have read Ecclesiastes? It's one of those weird books, and a lot of people don't ever get to it. Now, he says that he is the son of the king, and that he is a king himself. So a lot of people think that maybe Solomon wrote this, but he doesn't say. He just says, he just calls himself the teacher. And so the teacher begins Ecclesiastes by kind of looking around at the world. And he says, you know, people are born and people die. And that just kind of keeps happening over and over. And the seasons come and go and the winds blow. He says, you know, it's funny because the rivers are constantly flowing down to the ocean. But the ocean never actually fills up. Like, there's no completion to it. It just keeps doing the same thing over and over and over. And he says, people say to me, you need to come check this out because this is brand new. You need to come hear this or see this. It's original. And then he gets there and says, that's not original. That's nothing new. Which I find very interesting that the song we're looking at today is not an original. I'm sure when the animals recorded that, everybody said, you've got to check out this song. I just heard it on the radio. It's new. It's something brand new. It's not new. It's been around forever. We don't even know where it came from. It's been around so long. They just took something that other people had done, changed it up a little bit. But anyway, the teacher says, you know, I can't find meaning and ultimate fulfillment in life. And so I'm going to try to seek after things that will make me feel that way. And he starts out by deciding that he is going to study. He is going to apply his mind to all the wisdom that's available. Philosophy, whatever sciences there were, astrology, whatever. He's going to study it all and see if being smart will make him feel fulfilled. Kind of like me getting my master's. Once I graduate. Then he says, I learned that this too is just a chasing after the wind. For with much wisdom comes much sorrow, and more knowledge the more grief. So studying ultimately didn't make him feel good. And his phrase that he continues to say throughout the book of Ecclesiastes is, there's nothing new under the sun. It's all the same. There's nothing to be gained under the sun that makes me feel ultimately satisfied. So chapter 2, if you have your Bibles, I want to read to you a bit of chapter 2. Ecclesiastes chapter 2, I'm going to start in verse 1. He says, I said to myself, so he studied wisdom, right? He's studied everything that he could study. This is what he says. I said to myself, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good. But that also proved to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is madness. And what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly, my mind still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was good for people to do under the heavens during the few days of their lives. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water the groves of flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces. I acquired male and female singers and a harem as well, the delights of a man's heart. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my labor, and this was the reward for all my toil. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. He lists several things in there that perhaps you and I have tried a time or two when we are looking for that ultimate satisfaction. It's not just gambling and it's not just Amazon Prime. We've already mentioned studying. Some people think, well, perhaps if I can learn the right knowledge, that will bring ultimate satisfaction. He turns to wine. We all know people that have been caught in the trap of alcohol. It doesn't really bring satisfaction, but it does numb that feeling, maybe, that I'm not satisfied. He turns to building projects, building houses and building all these great things. That could be someone maybe that you know who is looking for ultimate meaning in their career, thinking that perhaps if I could work really hard and get to this certain place within my career that I will finally feel accomplished and satisfied. He plants vineyards and gardens and fruit trees. In my old neighborhood, there was a guy, and I swear this guy was in his yard, working on his yard every single day. Every blade of grass was perfect. All the flower beds were mulched and manicured, and he won yard of the month, probably every month. But I think perhaps he was maybe looking for some kind of satisfaction in that work, thinking that his job that he was doing on his yard could fulfill him. The teacher says, I bought slaves. Well, this is the idea that perhaps if I could exhibit power over other people, if people have to submit to me, maybe that will make me feel accomplished or satisfied. He owned herds and flocks. Now, in this time, herds and flocks would be like the epitome of success. How do we show off our success today? The houses we live in, the cars we drive. This is the equivalent of that. He's got land and herds and flocks, and all of his neighbors know that he is successful. But it doesn't bring him satisfaction. He goes after silver and gold. Well, this is wealth. How many people do we know think that money will solve the problem? And so they do whatever they can to make as much money as they can before they die. But the teacher says it didn't work. He hired male and female singers. Now, this is the idea that perhaps if I could be entertained properly, if I go to the movies enough, I'll just stay on this perpetual high if I see all the right movies, or if I buy the right DVDs or have the right tech in my house, I've got a big screen TV, right? This idea that entertainment can somehow fulfill you. And then, of course, he says, I even had a harem. And this is sex. The idea that sex can somehow fulfill. But none of it worked. The teacher said, none of it worked. Nothing satisfied me. Now, somebody else did say that in the 60s, Jim. Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger.
I can't get no satisfaction. See, Mick knew it too. Everything I turn to, it's just not working. It's not bringing me satisfaction. And I didn't intend for this to happen, but I thought it was really, really interesting that the teacher says, there is nothing new under the sun. I have tried it all. I've denied myself nothing. I've tried every avenue, which is why he's calling himself the teacher. Listen to me, because I'm telling you it doesn't work. Tries everything under the sun. And what is the young man doing in the song? He's looking for fulfillment at night in the house of the rising sun. Gambling all night until the sun comes up. If the teacher didn't find it during the day, perhaps I'll find it at night. Philippians chapter 4, you got to love Paul, the Apostle Paul. I do love Paul. But Paul sometimes says some infuriating things. Paul says in Philippians 4, he says, "For I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through him who gives me strength." Paul says, I've learned the secret to contentment. But then he doesn't tell us what it is. Now, come on, Paul. I mean, we're all searching for contentment. You've learned the secret? I mean, he gives us just like a little hint. He says, I can be content through Christ who strengthens me. Okay, so there might be something there that we can pull out, perhaps. But he doesn't just outright tell us what is the secret to contentment. Have you guys heard of Augustine? Augustine was a convert to Christianity, became a bishop, became a theologian, did a lot of work in Christian theology in the 4th century, like in the 320s to 380s. He might have made it to 400, but wrote a lot of theological works and a lot of the things that we as Christians now adhere to and believe. Augustine kind of worked some of that stuff out. Great guy. But one of the things that he did, he wrote a book that's probably one of the most famous Christian books of all time. It would make the top 10 list, I think, in almost everybody's list. And it's called Confessions. Augustine's Confessions. Confessions is actually just a prayer. The whole thing is this prayer that he is praying to God, and we as the reader get to hear his prayer and read through it. And so he goes through and chronicles his whole life, being born and what it was like growing up in the household that he was in. His mother was a Christian, his father was not. And Augustine, very much like the teacher, as he got older, thought, I am not satisfied in life. I am dissatisfied, and I'm going to look to see where I can find that. And like the teacher, he did all the things the teacher did. He could have just read Ecclesiastes, but he didn't. So he tried all that. He studied under the best philosophers and studied other religions. He went after women, had many, many women, and just tried all the things that the teacher did, but came back just like the teacher and said, it didn't work. I am still unsatisfied in life. I don't have ultimate fulfillment or meaning or purpose. And then in Confessions, in his prayer, he says, you know, I wonder if the fact that we as humans are all kind of walking around dissatisfied tells us about our relationship to God. I wonder if our dissatisfaction proves some kind of connection between God and humans. And then he wrote
probably the most famous words in the book of Confessions. In his prayer, he says, God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. Let me read that again. You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. This was the conclusion that Augustine came to. The fact that I'm dissatisfied means that I was built for relationship with God, and that's the only place that I'm going to find ultimate fulfillment. This is the only place that you can find true happiness. Think about all the ways that we try to define ourselves or find that purpose or meaning. You aren't defined by where you go. You're not defined by what you know. You aren't defined by how much you have in this life. You're not defined by what kind of job you do. Augustine says, you're not defined by who you are, but by whose you are. That's a radical shift in thinking. You're not defined by who you are. Whatever your life looks like, you're defined by whose you are. Who made you? The one that you are to be in relationship with. The fact that you're dissatisfied proves that you are made to be intimately connected to God, and your ultimate purpose and satisfaction and fulfillment can only be found in that relationship. The secret to happiness is in knowing whose you are. Now, Paul may have answered that question somewhere else. I'm sure that he did. He didn't write there. But Jesus did say something, and I told the kids earlier, Matthew chapter 11. This is famous set of verses too. Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. We're looking for rest for our souls, and Jesus says, you can only find it in me. You were made for relationship. So the lesson from the song today and from the teacher is that whether you're gambling in the house of the rising sun or you're looking for fulfillment in other things under the sun, ultimately you will be dissatisfied. That Amazon package, the high that comes from that only lasts for so long. All the other things that you think might make you feel fulfilled, they're not going to work. Only Jesus can give us rest. And that sounds easy, but boy, that's hard to do. How do we lay down those burdens and rest in Jesus? That is the lesson. That is the thing that we want to do. And so our prayer is that Jesus would show us how to do that so that we could be ultimately satisfied in Him. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the lessons of the teacher. We thank you for the witness from the animals telling us that, hey, I've tried the house of the rising sun and it didn't work. The message is clear to us, Father. We see it time and time again, but yet we strive. We try things out. We work hard at things that make us feel good for a second, but then eventually the feeling wears out. Help us. Help us look to you and to you alone for that ultimate meaning and fulfillment and satisfaction. Because our hearts are restless, and they will remain restless until they find their rest in you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.